Hi,
I'm Apple.
And I'm Linguine.
We're here to talk about food, the nutrients in food, and how your body converts them to a nice usable form and takes them in for use of maintenance of body structures and the energy you need to work, walk, talk, dance, read and write, and even think.
Suppose you went out to eat with your friends and you decided to have a nice piece of sushi, say, California roll. Well, you'd be making a good start to eating some things that are very good for you.
So let's take a look at the plate icon from choosemyplate.gov. It gives you an idea of what sort of things you should eat a whole lot of and what sort of things you should eat sparingly.
The basis for the whole thing is water. Lots and lots of it. 8 glasses a day, in fact. That's 64 ounces. But it doesn't all have to come in glasses. You can get your water in lots of ways. There's water in soda and milk and tea and coffee. There's water in celery and soup and in fruits like watermelon, right?
Yep, and don't forget apple. There's plenty of water there and plenty of nice, tangy taste.
Right, apple. You know, linguine is also quite tasty.
Not without sauce. You're kind of plain, you know.
I'm going to ignore that. Okay, so let's talk sushi. In a California roll, you have rice, fish, and greens, specifically seaweed, also called nori, as well as cucumber and avocado. Rice would go to the grain portion of the plate. If you were talking about types of nutrients, what would rice be, Apple?
Well, it's a starch, and a starch is a form of carbohydrate. And there are two kinds of carbohydrates.
What's the other form?
The other form is sugar. Sugar and starch are both forms of carbohydrates, and they are pretty much chains or polymers of glucose. You get starch from plants and glycogen, a complex sugar, from animals. The basic building block unit of starch is amylose. For sugars, we usually think of glucose. In fruits like me, the sugar is fructose, and all carbohydrates are pretty much good fuel.
Okay, back to the sushi. Where do the greens fit in the scheme of things?
Well, they're vegetables. And vegetables have lots of vitamins, sugar, and fiber, and you need about 2 to 2.5 cups daily. Another good source of fiber is fruits, which you should eat about 2 cups of. So maybe a fruit cup would be a great option for dessert.
Fiber?
I'll tell you more about fiber later, Linguine.
And what about fish?
Like poultry and milk, it's a good source of protein. These foods should always be present in your diet, and you need 5.5 ounces every day. You need protein to build bones, muscles, skin, cell membranes, and oh yes, enzymes. All enzymes are forms of proteins, but we'll learn about them in a minute.
Isn't there some oil in fish too? And I know there's fat in milk.
Yep. And those foods aren't as lean as good old pasta.
Well, you know, there's such a thing as too much of a good thing. You could get kind of hefty from too much pasta. But that's right, there are some oils in fish, otherwise known as lipids, and fats, which are a combination of carbohydrate and lipid. You should go very, very, very easy on oily foods and also on sweets, like chocolate. I should also say that I like a teensy-weensy bit of sesame seeds in my California roll. They should be eaten sparingly, which is fine. I said teensy-weensy.
You know, Linguine, I'm starting to think that sushi must be very good for you. There's a lot of the things you're supposed to eat most of, like vegetables, and then a medium amount of fish and grains for protein and carbohydrates, and a little bit of oil and nuts. So really, that's kind of perfect.
You know what? You're right. And suppose you dip your roll in a little bit of nice, sweet nitsumi sauce. I think that's made of eel and sugar.
Ooh, when I smell that stuff, I feel my mouth water.
Very good, Apple. That's the perfect segue. Let's talk about how your body digests its food. Let's talk about the digestive tract.
Well, our guy here, he looks pretty hungry. So let's feed him some California roll and see what happens. Ooh, I'll bet his mouth's watering right now.
That's right, Apple. Because, like just about everything in your body, including the visceral organs of the gastrointestinal tract, the brain's in charge. Your brain picks up all sorts of stimuli, such as smells, sights, sounds, and associates them with different foods, which can get the first part of the digestive system revved up and ready to go.
My mouth is watering, but I know that that isn't water. It's salivary enzymes dissolved in water. From here and there, the most important salivary enzyme is amylase. Amylase digests or breaks down starch or amylose. And so digestion starts right here up in the mouth. Your incisors tear and your molars grind away, and so the mechanical part of digestion starts. As a piece of food is ground up into smaller pieces and mixed with water to start breaking up the carbohydrates. Also, the food passes over the tongue, which is full of taste buds that sense sweet and sour and bitter, and your salivary glands are going into overdrive.
Eventually, the food, now pretty gooey, passes through the pharynx and into the esophagus. That's the long muscular tube that runs from the back of your mouth, the throat, all the way down behind your lungs and into the stomach. Whenever you swallow, a little flap called the epiglottis covers the opening into your airway, so food goes into the esophagus only. Once the food is in the esophagus, you might think it's just gravity that moves the food along. But if you lay down while you eat, well, the food still moves to the stomach. It does this because of peristalsis. The muscular tissue of the esophagus contracts and relaxes, contracts and relaxes. This wave action moves the food along. To tell you the truth, you could stand on your head and peristalsis would still do the trick, but I don't recommend it. Once the food has moved to the bottom of the esophagus, it passes through a little pinch point called the pyloric sphincter. There are two, one at the top of the stomach and one at the bottom. They keep what's what right where it should be, if you know what I mean.
I do, and I even know what happens next. Once the food passes into the stomach, well, the stomach starts heaving and twisting. It's really more like a muscular bag that can churn and contract and expand. There's lots of action there, and that action breaks up the food even more. It's the presence of the food itself that activates stretch receptors and keeps that stomach moving.
About how big is the stomach?
Your stomach can hold about 2 liters at maximum capacity. So you can wash down your California roll with a whole 2-liter bottle of soda if you really wanted to, I suppose, but that's pretty disgusting. So one thing about the stomach that's interesting is that it's full of acid. That digestive enzyme, pepsin, is secreted into the lumen, or middle, or the stomach from the glands in those thick muscular walls. The pepsin only works in a very acidic environment.
Acidic like apple juice?
Yeah, you're an amateur, Linguine. Acidic like vinegar. It has about a pH of 2.0, which is pretty low on the pH scale. Pepsin is an enzyme that breaks up peptide bonds, which hold together proteins. So the proteins are made of chains of amino acids, and the pepsin breaks these long, complexly folded chains up into shorter, straighter ones called peptides.
Wow. What keeps the pepsin from just eating the stomach itself?
That's a good question, Linguine. Well, the walls of the stomach are coated with mucus to protect them. When that mucus is disrupted, sometimes people get ulcers. The acid of the stomach burns the underlying layers of the wall, and it can be pretty painful.
But let's get back to our California roll. We have broken it up into little pieces in the mouth and mixed it with water. We've broken down some of the starches and the rice and the seaweed and vegetables with amylase. We've moved the food into the stomach, where we've partially digested the proteins of the fish. And everything is a kind of goopy thick soup now, called chyme. The chyme passes through the second of the pyloric sphincters and into the topmost part of the small intestine. That area is called the duodenum.
Now in the duodenum, you have inputs from the pancreas, liver, and the gallbladder, all producing digestive juices and enzymes. The liver makes bile, which emulsifies fats. So you're going to be physically disrupting and dissociating some of the fishy oils and fats in the sesame seeds. The liver makes the bile, but it does store it in the gallbladder for release into the intestine as needed. The pancreas does two things. First of all, it secretes substances that work to neutralize the low pH of the chyme as it emerges from the stomach. It also secretes other digestive enzymes, primarily lipases and peptidases, that break up fats and proteins into much smaller building block molecules that can be transported across the walls of the cells that line the small intestine.
The absorption of nutrients and the resorption of bile salts occurs all along the small intestine in all three parts, the duodenum, the jejunum, and the ileum. The small intestine is called small, but it really should be called narrow. It's about 1 inch in diameter, but about 20 feet long. And it's got all of these folds called villi all along the length. And then the folds have more folds called microvilli. This increases the surface area tremendously to about the size of a basketball court. You want all that surface area because digestion will be mostly finished in this part, and you'll want to have plenty of surface tissue made of cells that are specialized for transport of nutrients from the inside of the digestive tract across the cells lining the tract, and then into the blood vessels and tissues that make up the rest of the body. It's like when you want to check out at Walmart, you hope there are lots and lots of checkouts open and active so you can get your groceries from the supermarket to your car easily. So, what gets absorbed in the small intestine? Water and electrolytes, like sodium, chloride, and bicarbonate. Carbohydrates, after digestion to monosaccharides or simple sugars. Proteins, after digestion to small peptides and amino acids. Neutral fat, after digestion to monoglyceride and free fatty acids.
Right. And all of this occurs in about 6 to 10 hours from when the meal was eaten. But finally, what's left of that meal? Anything that can't be digested, which is our fiber, Linguine, that moves into the large intestine. We don't have the enzymes to break up fibrous materials that are found in plants, like seaweed, and in some fruits. They are undigestible components of animal foods as well. All of these pass from the large intestine, which is about twice as wide as the small intestine, but much shorter.
Like the small intestine, the large intestine's job is mostly absorption, or rather resorption. The large intestine's walls take up the water that's in the chyme. In fact, as what's left of our California roll passes through the large intestine, the water is removed, and the goop gets more and more and more solid. This part of the process can take 24 to 48 hours. Once it gets to the end of the large intestine, called the colon, it's pretty solid. More peristalsis pushes it out through the rectum. First it was food, then it was goop, and now it's poop.
Was that really necessary, Linguine?
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be, tasteless.